Welcome to the 23rd video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this chapter, we're going to be discussing the quantum mechanics of bosons and of fermions. On the left, I have an image of black body radiation, which is the characteristic image of bosons, in this case, the boson being a photon. And in the center, I have a stack of different metals. Fermions are most commonly described in terms of electrons and solids, unless you're doing high energy physics. And so all metals are behaving in many respects like fermionic gases. And that's why that provides a good example for what fermions are. Chapter 17, Bosons and Fermions. The key issue with quantum mechanics when we get into many particle states is that the particles are indistinguishable from one another. What this means is when I interchange the two particles, they have to either return the same quantum state or the negative of the quantum state. It turns out when you look at bosons, that corresponds to the case where it returns the state itself, and those are called symmetric states. One of the best examples of that is the Hongu-Mandel experiment, which looks at what happens when identical photons are put through a beam splitter. And what you find is the photons want to stay together. That's called photon bunching. And the Hongu-Mandel experiment is the best example of it. When we first introduced this back in chapter 4, we did a little bit of a sneak in part of the derivation. And here we discuss what that sneak was and how to actually do it properly. It's probably the one time in the book where I did something that was a little bit under the table, but we correct it here because we needed to know a little bit more about the advanced ideas regarding what many body states look like in order to properly correct it. Nothing is wrong in what was given in Chapter 4, but it wasn't generalizable beyond that one case that we looked at, which was a 50-50 beam splitter. Then we move on to talking about fermions and antisymmetric states. It turns out, at least in condensed matter physics, nearly everything that you do works with fermions, not bosons, because electrons are fermions. The fermions correspond to the case with a minus sign, which is called an antisymmetric state. And it takes a lot of work to understand properly how to deal with them because you have these sign changes that occur all the time and you have to properly take those into account. Along the way, we get into a more formal way of describing second quantization and how to work with fermionic creation and annihilation operators. Let's go browse through the chapter. So for chapter 17, our quote is from the Dalai Lama, who was also a Nobel laureate. Reason well from the beginning, and then there will be never any need to look back with confusion and doubt. A lot of the way in which this chapter is developed fits really well with this quote because we're going to start by the reasoning that in order to make things indistinguishable, we have to look at these totally symmetric or totally antisymmetric states. And once we've gotten that sorted out, then we just have to spend most of our time working through figuring out exactly how we carry that out in calculations. So we start off with a key notion on quantum mechanics of elementary particles, which is that all electrons are the same, all photons are the same, they're indistinguishable. And because they're indistinguishable, we have to do something with our formalism. It isn't that you have to do anything special in the way that you treat the quantum mechanics of objects that are indistinguishable. The problem is when we write down a formula to represent a quantum state, we have to pick an ordering for our particles. I have to say, this is electron one, this is electron two. And unless I do something to my formal expressions, they remain having that label. So I have to add in all other possible ways of expressing the result in such a way that I can no longer distinguish which one is particle one and which is particle two. So that's a process that involves us adding lots and lots of near copies of the same thing, but with different labels. And if I had to do this for a large number of particles, it gets very laborious and tedious and very difficult to manage. So what happens is we have this technique, which is called second quantization, which we're going to be coming up with, that kind of handles all of that for us. Here's an image of Bose. Bose is the first person to recognize the symmetric properties of bosons. And then he and Einstein worked on a number of the consequences, including Bose-Einstein condensation. Here you see we're creating states now with these second quantization operators, these so-called creation and annihilation operators. They look just like harmonic oscillator raising and lowering operators, and they're very closely related. And by working with them, we reduce a lot of the problems that we have with regards to the labels. It's much easier to form the symmetric and anti-symmetric states in terms of those creation and annihilation operators. We spend some time here now eventually talking about black body radiation because we now finally have enough information that we can actually talk about it. And of course, we have to pay tribute to Planck, who is the star of figuring out how black body radiation worked, and in many respects, starting the work on what quantum mechanics really is. Part of working with indistinguishable particles involves knowing how to properly count states. It is not so simple. So we go through how this works for distinguishable particles, for fermions, and for bosons. We talk about some of the interesting ideas like boson sampling. We look at how you can actually perform summations over all possible boson states, and that way you can actually derive the Planck distribution function for black body radiation. Then we come back and we look at the Hong-U-Mandel experiment again. Of course, you can't do that without also talking about Hanbury, Brown, and Twiss. Now we're doing it with our second quantized form, working with the operators. And we're looking now very carefully at the way things work with a beam splitter. And here we're looking at the case where the beam splitter is not necessarily a 50-50 beam splitter. And that requires us to work a little bit more carefully to get everything right. So we're in essence coming back and correcting something that we didn't do it wrong because we worked with a 50-50 beam splitter, but we might have been a little bit misleading in what we had done. And so everything is corrected technically here. All right, then we move on to fermions. Fermions, of course, named after Enrico Fermi. And these are the particles that don't like each other. They obey Pauli exclusion principle. They have anti-symmetric states. The classic way of describing them in first quantization is using something called a Slater determinant. Once you have a reasonable number of electrons, you recognize that working with Slater determinants is an incredibly difficult and painful thing to do. So you try to find a way to get around that. And that's what second quantization is. Second quantization is a way to get through that. Before talking about that, we do talk about some important things that you need to know about fermions, such as Fermi temperatures, what a degenerate Fermi gas is, the Fermi pressure, and so forth. These are all things that are coming from the Pauli exclusion principle. And now we move into second quantization for fermions. With second quantization, instead of working with this summation of lots and lots of terms and all possible permutations and so forth, we're going to instead represent these states in terms of operators acting on a state using what are called the fermionic creation and annihilation operators. And this idea of going from these Slater determinants, which are painful to work with, into operators acting on a set of states, we now call them Fock states due to this person, Vladimir Fock, who was a remarkable quantum mechanic. He single-handedly sort of fixed errors that people had in many important problems along the way. So when Hartree wanted to describe chemistry, he created an approximation that didn't include exchange terms, and Fock corrected it, which is why it's called the Hartree-Fock method. And we're going to talk about the Hartree-Fock method later when we talk about chemistry. He's the person who recognized that hydrogen has an SO4 symmetry. He also is the person who figured out the right way of directly solving for hydrogen wave functions in momentum space and so forth. He did a lot of interesting things. He wrote a quantum mechanics textbook, and he put none of these interesting things that he had done in the textbook. It's a very standard and straightforward textbook written around 1930 or so. It's still a nice textbook. It's nice to read, but he could have done so much better because he had done so many of these interesting things over his career, although some of those things he hadn't done quite by the time he had written his textbook. So there's lots of interesting things you got to work with when you're looking at working with fermionic operators. We talk about a very simple model of metals called jellium. And with jellium, we work on calculating different kinds of states and looking at the effect of the Coulomb repulsion and so forth. It's actually a very interesting model to look at. It gets you starting to have to worry about things that come up when you are looking at many-body physics and things that go beyond the single-particle quantum mechanics that we've been working on. Another important result for non-interacting fermions is something called Wick's theorem. It's a very surprising result. You can take very complicated matrix elements that involve multiple fermionic operators and reduce them into products of expectation values that just involve two operators, and that's a rather remarkable result. Here we have a very famous result about the energy of jellium, and we have a problem here where you actually go through and you determine those numbers. Then we talk about hopping of electrons on a lattice. This is called a tight binding model, and this is a standard way of describing non-interacting electrons in solids. It leads to things called Fermi surfaces and stuff like that. We don't go into a lot of detail with those objects themselves here because we're just giving a brief summary of how things work. Then, of course, there's a question of how do you actually work with them if you're going to think about doing something, let's say, with a computer and doing computer calculations. You have to understand how to work with these fermionic states. So we take some time talking about the different kinds of things and issues that you have to worry about as you're trying to work with these states and do calculations. We're going to get practice with working with that as well as we do what are called small cluster exact diagonalization studies. And those involve having to work directly with the operators and how they act on states. So we're going to get a lot of practice with that. And that takes us to the end of chapter 17. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.